Philippine Chairs playing catch-up today as we return from the Bonifacio Day holiday. Well, we are kicking off from 6780. That's a 2.5-month high. We are just, get this, 4.8% away from 2021's closing number. Imagine that. For more on the market action, Manny Ocampo of ICCP now joins us live. Manny, good morning.
Good morning, Mimi.
Good morning. So it looks like it is a good morning because the PSEI is still trading up today. No stopping the rally. It's up by 0.25%, 17 points. We're at 67.97. We might just break through, pierce through that 6,800 mark today. So I guess I want to ask you, how sustainable is this rally? How much more room for this to run?
Well, I guess up to the end of the year, we should have a Merry Christmas. Let me put it I think the numbers are strong up to the end of the year. What are we seeing? We're seeing, inflation that comes out, but in about a week or so, within expectations, maybe at the more than 8% or something like that. But more importantly, interest rates. I think we've seen where we've seen the highest already, or maybe a slowing down in rate increases. The peso has started to increase, and that has let people settle down as far as fears are concerned. So throw away 60, maybe we look at 55 up to the year end with remittances coming in. Now, remittances were delayed, from my understanding, pretty much because OFWs, overseas Filipinos, were waiting for 60. I guess it came to 60, touched 60, but
all right,
it's been a pretty since that.
Manny, it's not just the Philippines having a great run. In fact, Asia enjoyed its best November in a long, right, long time, beating global stocks by the most since 1993. Asian stocks are up 15% last month, led by Hong Kong, Taiwan, right, and the Philippines. The Nikko asset says the outperformance may actually continue into next year. Do you think so? Or do you think 2023 is going to be a different story?
Well, we're maybe not as optimistic about 2023 growth rate, for example. We're not coming off the low base compared to earlier this year or compared to 2021. We're on a higher base already in 2022. So growth will be there, but maybe slower than what we're seeing this year. I think corporates will also maybe start slowing down as far as their growth rates are concerned. We maybe expect, for example, third quarter, we saw corporates reporting growth on the average at about 20%+. Maybe this fourth quarter, if we're lucky, we'll see the same high numbers or high teens at the very least. First quarter, we're less optimistic, maybe mid-teens or so, as far as earnings growth is concerned.
All right. Let's take a look at the shorter term, though. Powell, the rate hike, the Fed speak we got overnight. Powell saying the rate hike will slow, but he did say that with a caveat that the adjustments are just the beginning. How should investors view that? It sounds like a double-edged sword.
Well, expect rates to still go up. I don't think the U.S. has not really cleared their inflation issues yet. Similar to us, inflation is still running, from what people say, we've been used to is still running high compared to what we've been used to over the past few years. But we come to think that, we should realize there are new realities. I think until we settle the supply chain disturbances caused by the Russia-Ukraine issue, maybe then we'll be seeing global inflation easing up.
All right.
That time,
Manny, after the Fed, what do you want to hear from the BSP? I mean, what do you think you'll hear when the Banco Central's Monetary Board, when they meet for the last time for the year on December 15th, just a day after the Fed?
Sure. I think BSP will pretty much maintain their same story, that they will match, they will keep that gap between, you know, they will match U.S. Interest rate hikes if that comes in. Governor Medalla will probably at the earliest maybe want to see inflation, you know, slowing down in a marked way before he starts saying that I will maybe raise rates slower than the U.S., something like that. I think he will also continue to make his spiel about, you know, shall we say, he'll probably say that, well, the peso has improved quite a bit, and he'll obviously pick on that. And, you know, with maybe a caution, if you'd like, to the banks to continue to behave, shall we say.
All right. And speaking of banks and the BSP said that bank lending actually went up 14% to 10.6 trillion pesos in October, boosted by a 20% rise in consumer loans. So the banking industry, that's that. The BSP is looking at November inflation. By the way, the data comes out next week. ANC covers that live every single time. They're seeing inflation settling within 7.4 to 8.2% range. More corporate stories that we have from this morning. We have this, Justin, Manny, DMCI Holdings 9-month order book coming in at 45.3 billion. It's actually down 8%. They're citing a slowdown in project bidding and awarding of contracts from both the public and the private sector. Quick comment. DMCI has been a favorite. They've been outperforming, and it's a dividend play. What do you think?
Rising interest rates. We'll blame the slowdown and the order book on that.
All right. But they're hoping that it's the public infrastructure side that could provide them with upside. Still, we have this, Justin, ASEN of the Ayala Group. They're looking to complete the acquisition of the Sinocalan Solar Power Corporation by December 15, end of last month. They actually just signed the deal with Sun Growers and let me get that other name to make sure I get that right. Sun Grow Power and Havila AAA Holdings. ASEN has been pretty challenged the last couple of months. How, when you look at the performance of the units of Ayala Corporation, ASEN is one of the weaker performers.
Yeah, but you know, ASEN, you have to take a look at it on the long-term view. I think you know, ASEN will pretty much still be there. Power will be needed, and there are costs to moving out of the fossil fuel base that they've had and going to greener renewable energy. Now, there's a cost to that because, you know, you're giving up, shall we say, power plants that provided you with the revenues and profits. Mm-hmm. These are baseload plants that they're moving out of. So that is taking a short-term hit, if you'd like. But I think over the next 2-3 years, as they you know, unfold or get into their renewable energy portfolio, that should do well for them over the long term, especially if fuel prices remain to be where they are. Right?
A bet on the future is what some are calling it. Speaking of renewables, Meralco Unit Spectrum is set to install a 2-megawatt peak solar system in Empedador's Laguna plant. Aboitiz-led Therma Marine also beginning the commercial operations for its first battery energy storage system, or BESS. And what about this one? Maybe I get your take on this one. Globe Unit and Ayala Corp. Set to pilot Taiwan's 2-wheeled EV. It's a smart scooter and battery swapping tech player Gogoro. They're bringing that to Manila. They're going to be launching first quarter of next year. E-vehicles, smart scooters, are you betting big on these if you look at the auto industry?
Yeah, it's surprising that it's Globe leading the path for that one on the Ayala side rather than, you know, maybe Ayala Automotive or Ayala Industries, you know. But I guess there's, I don't know, there must be a tech or a telecom play behind it. So,
all right. Yeah. I want to, still on the Ayala Group, A-REIT is planning to diversify into shopping malls. Instead of just the renewable energy facilities, they're going to acquire properties worth 30 to 45 billion in the next 3 years. And I wanted to get your take on this, Manny. What do you think of the proposed sovereign wealth fund, the Maharlika Fund, which could be as big as 250 billion pesos?
Right. Well, okay. As long as they have the safeguards to prevent one IMDb fiasco, we should be all right. I think it's a move in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. Because right now, Manny, you've got SSS, for example, already having funds to invest in local companies. Having this fund will pool bigger money and allow them to tap into international investments, correct?
Right. Again, there's a, well, it's a wealth fund, so you're approaching different markets, shall we say. No? And I think it's good for the government to pose something like that, to pull something like that. It really becomes a question of who manages the funds and what are the checks and balances they put in place.
All right.
For that kind.
All right. Yeah. Manny, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation. The blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely and that you like. Don't tell us, just describe. So what do you have for us today?
Okay, well, they will benefit from a, shall we say, a recovery in global trade, number one. No? Mm-hmm. And, you know, they've always been the lead company in their particular sector by in the Philippines and maybe even the region also. No? So we like the company. They're one of the PSEI stocks that, you know, will remain to be in the PSEI for the long time. So we're not worried about missing their,
What sort of upside are you seeing in the share price?
Okay. This company, you know, they've come up with better numbers. The third quarter, we expect the fourth quarter to show even better numbers. So 20-25% upside, approaching their highs over the last year.
All right, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Manny, always a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much for the time and the context today.